somewhere something good, and that somebody could able to protect their systems the way that it's necessary. But also, what I like to do, I like to compare physical world with the cyber world very often. So if you're talking about different cyber threats and risks and different kind of attacks, so this short amount of, you know, different types of cyber attacks like defacement, phishing, DDoS, ransomware, there's many other ones. I'd like to compare those with physical world. So this COVID-19, SARS, Ebola, you name it. There's lots of different threats in medical world as well. So actually those different kind of problems, they are not so different. And I have heard that many companies, they will say that we are so special and we have to focus on cyber issues somehow, you know, differently, because we are, you know, energy sector or we are the medical sector. But I like to ask from those companies that how you are exactly so different. So are you using different computers? Do you have some medical computers not running in Microsoft Windows? Do you have some different kind of routers, switches, firewalls, maybe another kind of IP protocols? No, you are using exactly the same thing that all the rest using. The only, maybe there is a 5% of difference if you're talking some special equipment, some special energy sector equipment, some special medical sector equipment. But all the time when I'm doing those presentations, I'd like to say that the world is not as bad as I'm presenting. I'd like to a little bit overreact in those situations. And if you're coming back to this cyber issue, many years, maybe 10, 15 years, I have seen the situation that cybersecurity is somehow like IT problem. Lots of different managers, they explain that this is cyber issue. Don't come to the management board. So go and fix and solve this issue somewhere inside of the IT department. And then you're gonna see the situations when the core business will stop, the hospital's gonna stop, or any other company core business gonna stop. And I like to ask from those managers or for management, is it actually the IT problem if your core business is stopped, or is it more like strategic problem? And then from one side, it's good to see that cyber gonna come more and more, you know, a strategic issue, and the manager is going to understand more that we have to focus on cyber and so on and so on. So if you're talking about the pandemic, then everybody understands that current situation with this COVID-19, that we have to, every single person have to do something to stop the situation. We have to wash our hands, wear our masks, and all kinds of different things. We cannot travel anymore. I have been in Sri Lanka many times. I'd very like to be in Sri Lanka. I very like to stand right now in front of all of you somewhere in the conference center and do this presentation, not sitting in my home. And I don't know anymore, am I working at home or I'm living in work, because everything is mixed and then all the situation is changed. But in cyber world, let's say the way, we had this pandemic already 15 years, and not all the people understand that we have this pandemic. But luckily, again, this situation changing, but it's changing quite slowly. If you're talking about the management, then the managers quite often say that I don't know nothing about the cyber. I never saw any hacker. I never saw any incident. So from my side, why should we care? I'd like to also say that I don't know anyone who have been COVID-19 tested positive. Zero. Never saw. So I don't understand what is the pandemic, why I can't be in Sri Lanka, why I have to wear the mask and wash my hands, I don't know, 10 times more often than I'm doing usually. But sometimes you have to see the big picture before you're starting to do any kind of different decisions. So question is not about on you, but the question is what's happening around. So what is the situation in the whole field or whole this domain? So we saw, unfortunately this video is not playing, let's try to do it a different way. We saw quite often the situation that when the management doesn't understand the importance of cyber, and not only the management, all the business side, you know, owners, business owners, they don't understand why we have to do those penetration testing and why we have to focus on cyber and why we have to have cyber budget and all other resources. And then when we come live with some new information systems, then the IT department or cyber department, they are dealing exactly as it is in this video. So we are fixing those problems when we are hitting live with our new information systems. But my point is that we have to be aware and know, how to say, skillful enough, and our knowledge have to be in place enough. We are fixing those issues before we are going live. And again, with the COVID as well, so worldwide, many of the different organizations, they were aware that some kind of similar situation may happen. Some of those organizations, countries, hospitals, they did different test preparations to be ready for big kind of pandemic. But many of those institutions and many of those organizations, they just didn't care. They are waiting this situation, they start to deal with this situation when this situation actually going to face us. So actually, this cyber world we're living in, we have lots of different threats around us, and the only difference between the physical world and the cyber world is actually that in physical world, more or less we are able to see all those traps, risks, vulnerabilities. But in cyber world, we cannot see them, and we have to somehow learn to see where are those traps, where are those risks, and how to handle those. We all are this white mouse with helmet or without helmet, and we just, you know, hoping that we are not stepping on any of those traps. So when management or someone from the management can ask from me how to measure that we are good in cyber, and I saw one of the most wrong answer, that let's measure how much incidents do we have. So this is what I have heard many times, and this is something that I have to explain all the time. If you want to see small amount of incidents or no incidents at all, just go and fire your IT department. Don't hire any cybersecurity persons, and you cannot see any of those incidents. Because, you know, if in the physical world, if someone gonna break into your house, stealing your TV in your living room, you don't have this TV. You're coming home after the hard working day, stepping in your living room, there is no TV. In cyber world, if someone can break into your systems and steal your data, basically copying your data, you have your data, bad guys have your data, so you may not know. And we have lots of examples when the companies getting this information that someone have stole our data many years later, because they don't have in place proper monitoring mechanism, proper scanning mechanism, and they don't have good IT / cybersecurity persons in their company. So we cannot never measure situation the way that small incidents, it means that, or small amount of incident, it actually means that everything is okay, and big amount of incident actually means that everything is in bad shape. Actually, it's vice versa. The more capable you are in this field, the more different incidents you see, and actually the better you are, and less you see, it means that actually you're blind. So we have to learn how to open our eyes. Bad guys are always one step ahead of us. So they developing new different kinds of malwares, new different types of or different methodologies how to attack, and we are like running behind those guys and trying to fix this situation. Exactly, if you compare this medical world, so if there's going to be a new virus, we cannot have vaccine before we saw this virus. So in the internet or cyber world, exactly the same thing. We have to wait bad guys do when they develop something new, and then we start to develop some proactive measures how to avoid to be a victim. I also like to compare with the military, because in cyber world we have to be prepared, and we have to actually do different kind of exercises and play through different kind of scenarios, especially if you're talking the national level, and also if you're talking organizational level, we have to play through different kind of scenarios. But again, this playing game or doing some exercises is something that management quite often don't understand why we are wasting time for that. And if I have to explain to the management level that why do we have to do different kind of exercises and play through different scenarios, then good example is your home. So one thing is compliance. So you know that we have backup, we have antivirus, we have this and that. Compare your home. We have smoke detectors, we have fire extinguisher in somewhere in the corner. So all the measures are in place, and more or less we are okay. But the point is that even if you have those things, at least you think that you have those things or those measures in place, those measures may not help you. Those measures may be absolutely useless. If you have this fire extinguisher at your home, but you never use this, you don't know how to use this fire extinguisher, but you have good feeling that I have fire extinguisher with my house, if something gonna happen, I can take it and remove the fire. But the actual situation is that if your wife or child is home and there's gonna be fire somewhere, compliance is in place, you have this fire extinguisher, but the actual benefit is close to zero because nobody knows how to use it. All those big cases, what I saw in industries when the companies are losing their data because of the ransomware attack, the point is that all those companies, the first question is, don't you have your backups? So why you're losing your data? The question is not about the backups. Do you have this backup or do you not have this backup? The question is that, is the restoring process working? So you may have your backup. IT department is doing backups daily basis, several times per day. But this one time when something actually gonna happen and you need to restore your systems from the backup, the restoring procedures doesn't work. So compliance, everything is okay. Yes, I have backup. But to do this restoring, testing, restoring process, weekly basis, monthly basis, quarterly, it's a boring thing, and IT department don't like to do this. So small pieces of different activities may help us to be a victim or to lose our data or maybe to lose our whole business. Usually, if you're talking about management side of view, what I saw quite often, again, that the management can give you to the CISO, Chief Information Security Officer, yes, you have resources and the mandate from us, so please go and do everything. So huge budget to buy different kind of protective measures, firewalls, encryptions, antivirus software, and so on. But please do this the way that won't gonna consider us. So go and do it in all the rest on the organization, but please do it the way that it won't gonna consider us. I remember once when I was responsible for Estonian Ministry of Finance cybersecurity, then one minister said to me that, yes, you have a mandate, yes, you have a budget, everything is in place, go do it, whatever you have to do, but please do it the way that doesn't consider me. So I don't like to use strong passwords. I don't like to use passwords at all. All doors have to be open for me, and so on. So again, we could spend lots of money for different measures. Compliance could look like excellent, you know, everything is okay. And then we have this Dave, this human error, and not only human error, but human mistake sometimes. And then all those thousands, hundreds of thousands of US dollars or euros, whatever the currency is basically wasted money, because this is one human being and can destroy everything, because no one actually considered how to educate the people, how to do different awareness raising campaigns, and how to fix or how to set up your systems the way that human beings are not able to do huge errors or mistakes in your system. And also, if you're talking about this awareness raising campaign, then it's quite simple to explain to the people fact-based knowledge. And if I'm doing those awareness raising campaigns, I usually never gonna tell to the people something new. At least I hope that they know most basic things, fact-based things. What is strong password? Everybody knows what is strong password. You have to do backups. Everybody knows you have to do backups. You have to have up-to-date software. Again, everybody knows it. But if you're talking about personality, attitude, and discipline, then our fact-based knowledge and our actual behavior is totally different things. So my aim, if I'm doing trainings or presentations, to change this mindset. So you have to change the mindset. Yes, you know something, but it's not good enough if you know. You have to behave the way to change this situation. Good example from Estonia is, I don't know what is the situation in Sri Lanka, but in Estonia, for example, everybody know that smoke detector is, you know, saving your life. But official statistics will show that 30% of the Estonian doesn't have smoke detector at home. So the question is, why don't they have this at home? Because just all the people know that this is useful thing and it's going to save your life. Another thing is, and then of course the question raised, is this smoke detector too expensive? No, it costs something like $5. Everybody could have it. But the attitude, you know, nothing going to happen with me. It's for, you know, other people going to need this, and then I don't need this, and so on and so on. So more important is to change people's attitude and discipline than to change people's knowledge. Because usually, of course, I don't want to say that knowledge is important, but usually we have this knowledge. It's easy to provide this fact-based knowledge, but it's much more difficult to change the attitude and discipline. So today also, the aim of this presentation is new mindset, going to give you the new result, not only the new facts or knowledge, but the new mindset. Simple example of mindset. If you are talking about computer, so in the left upper corner, we have a computer. You all know the basic things of computer. So antiviruses, updated software, encrypted hard drive, locked screen, and so on and so on. Also, we all know the same thing of this laptop. So this is also computer, basically all the policies and things are same if you're using computer or laptop. But if you're using this tablet in the left bottom corner, or the phone in the right bottom corner, then somehow our mindset will say that this is phone. And think for a second, what is the actual technical difference between this computer, tabletop computer, and between the phone? Only physical size is different. The content and the technical, how to say, technical ability is exactly the same. We are reading the emails, we are surfing in the web, opening attachments, working with documents, playing games, all the things are exactly the same. In this so-called phone or so-called computer. But think when and how people are actually using antivirus software in the phone. Nope. Because we are calling it phone. But my point is, this is the first example when we have to change our mindset that this is not the phone, this is computer, small computer fitting our pocket, but this is computer, and we have to use all the measures to protect the phone the way we are protecting the computer. Because this is old mindset that this is phone. You know why? Because this is phone in the left side. In the right side, this is actually computer. The calling function is the function we're using less in this device. So this is pocket computer, let's agree, and this is phone. I remember there was once there was a joke. All the jokes were coming from real life. There was a 7-year-old girl came back from school and lost his smartphone. And the mother is arguing at home, so how it's possible that you are losing your phone? And the little lady was very sad and also upset and asking from mother, haven't you lost phone when you was, you know, young? And then the short answer is, mother said that no, it was impossible to lose my phone because my phone looked like in this left side. So this old mindset that we have phone in our pocket is changing disturbing to change our mindset. But nowadays, we are not calling with phones, we are calling with the computers. Anyway, another important thing is, again, unfortunately, my videos is not playing here. Another important thing is that is that we have to learn from others' mistake. And I saw many times when something happened somewhere and the same thing gonna happen in different companies all over again and all over again. And my question is always, can't you learn from other mistakes? And the answer is basically no. We have to feel our own problems. We by our own, and then we are able to, you know, change our mindset on different activities. But my strong suggestion is that please change your mindset and change your situations when something happened with other ones. So this is important. Let's start from couple of examples. So I will skip some of the slides, but I will give you a couple of simple examples. This is like a joke, like anecdote in Estonia. So next generation cyber attack, rats cut Estonian e-government from the internet. So basically there were cables somewhere. And rats just cut off the cable. So when you're doing your different risk assessments, how often are you gonna think to the situation that we have somewhere in the basement cables and rats are able to cut our cables? So usually we are not think of that kind of situation. Again, if you see some unique situation from somewhere, you have to always think, is this possible that at my home, a similar kind of situation can happen? If you see your neighbor house in fire, you have to ask from neighbor what happened, and you have to fix this in your house, because only then you can be sure that my house will not going to be a fire. So you have to collect lots of different examples, lots of different information from all over the world to understand where are the different threats. Again, this is unique example that rats are actually cutting cables, but if you're doing your internal risk assessment inside of your company or in the national level, because those cables at this example, there were cables for the Estonian e-government system, so basically our e-government were down because of the rats. Another example we had also in Estonia, there was optical cable somewhere not digged enough deep to the underground, and some birds were knocking down of those cables and ruining optical cables. So again, simple things, because why I'm putting those examples here, this rats and also the birds, in the end of the day, there is no difference What was the reason of cyber incident? Was this rats or actually hackers, crackers, mother of nature? The point is, you are losing your services, you're losing your data. So we have to focus to all different situations at the same time. So also, for example, think your home situation. You have in your home your computer. Mostly all the important information, all the pictures are in one computer. If someone can attack this computer with ransomware, you're losing your all the pictures, for example, from all the birthdays and weddings and travel pictures and so on, so on. But if this computer can fall down from the table, it's gonna break. You're gonna lose your pictures the same way. So in the end of the day, the reason, what was the reason of this damage, doesn't actually matter. You have to protect different things the same way. But of course, mostly we are facing the cyber criminals. Cybercrime nowadays is the most secure way to commit crime. So basically, if you're comparing this physical world with the virtual world, you have riots in the street. There's lots of cyber criminals, they are attacking us, and the only thing what we can do, we can protect our environment. So we are building higher borders, putting bulletproof glasses to our environment, and no one is removing those bad guys from the streets. So we are talking about cyber streets, not the physical streets. Another example is if you're talking about the Internet of Things, I'd like to say Internet of Threats. So think for a second, who knows all the single things connected to internet in your organization? You can think that, most probably the IT guys know. I could say that no, they don't know, because no one actually is mapping or scanning enough their infrastructure to get the whole picture, whole up-to-date picture, what is connected to internet. Every device what is connected to internet has TCP ports, has IP address, and every IP address has TCP ports and UDP ports. 65,000 TCP ports, 65,000 UDP ports. So basically, every device what has IP address has also 130,000 different doors and windows. Someone has to take care of all those doors and windows. I never saw, never, any of the company who has this whole up-to-date picture of all the doors and windows. So basically, who has everyday up-to-date picture or this scanning results of all the IP addresses, all the devices connected to internet, and what is the situation with all the different access lists to the different ports. So this is the problem. The virus needs one single window to come inside of your premises. And if you don't know, if you don't see, if you're not able to manage all your doors and windows, basically game is over for you. We have so many examples everywhere. I don't want to stay long in those examples. So different camera systems open everywhere, at homes, at offices, and everywhere. And the sad thing is, in this bottom right corner, you see even the bathrooms. So where are the cameras? So most probably people are not want to publish this information to the wide web, but they did. Another example is all kind of smart houses, different kind of, you know, ventilation system, heating system, alarm systems, open to the internet. This is one of the office building also in Tallinn. Again, all the ventilation systems, elevators, fire alarms, heating, everything is open to the internet. Just another example. This is some kind of cooking, I don't know, device. There is a different kind of, you know, salt, sugar, so on, so on. So basically, they're doing croissants. So nowadays, everybody has something connected to internet. And if they have lots of similar things connected to internet, and they don't know how to protect those devices, so basically, for the bad guys, this is two different things. One thing is that they are able to attack you and disturb your business, everyday business. Another thing is that they can use your premises to commit another attacks. So so you have to take care of all the devices. I have many examples. I don't want to stay it long. This is basically free car wash. So again, some company set up the car wash business, and the operating system of this car wash was, you know, just like that, open for the wide web. So basically, if you know the URL, you can go wash your cars, not pay for the services, and so on. But if the same car wash company has also 100,000 liters diesel, let's say, tanks underground, and the pumps for those tanks are open. So every child basically are able to connect to those diesel or gasoline tanks and start to pump out the gasoline in the middle of the capital of city, then, you know, the situation is quite bad. But the thing what considers me most is still the medical sector. If you're reading the news that different kind of pacemakers, this heart stimulators or insulin pumps are vulnerable, so they're all configured by the Bluetooth, for example. This Bluetooth is not protected enough. So can you imagine that some teenager going to the school in the morning, sitting in the bus, trying to connect his Bluetooth earphones to the phone, and also discovers many other devices, connects to those devices and switching off someone's insulin pump or pacemaker. So if we are not protecting those simple devices around us, it's going to be quite difficult to protect our environment. And all those last examples, what I just showed you, this is, you know, the question is not that someone is strongly attacking those devices. The question is how those owners of those information systems are actually protecting. And then the simple answer is they're not protecting devices enough. So if you're not doing the minimum baseline of security, the game is over before it starts. So my main recommendation usually to the single citizen or to the companies and organizations are that you have to be little over the average. Bad guys are not putting lots of efforts to do the same kind of attacks to the strongly secured companies. They like to, you know, collect those low-hanging fruits and the below-the-average companies. So you have to be little over the average. You have to have backups in place, restoring mechanisms in place, software is up-to-date, proper antivirus, awareness raising done for your employees, and you are little over the average. And the probability to get hit by the cyber attack will decrease, I don't know, 10 times. So basically, if you are in the desert and lion attacking you, to escape from the lion, you don't have to be faster than lion. You have to be faster than your friend. You understand the point? Because mostly those attackers, they're focusing on those low-hanging fruits. And these current examples that I just gave you, no one is protecting their own infrastructure. And for bad guys, it's quite easy targets. But if you're talking about medical sector, then from one side, hospital leaders quite often have said that they are unprepared for different cybersecurity threats. From one side, I understand the situation. Their focus is somewhere else. Obviously, their main focus is to treat people and fight with different actual real-life viruses. And if they have to share the budget between the, you know, medical issues and cyber issues, most probably they will put the biggest amount of budget to the medical issues. But they have to understand that they are so vulnerable to the different cyber attacks that they have to be prepared. There's nothing else to wait. I will give you, again, I have plenty of examples, but I try to explain you the situation. So if somewhere is actual real war, also different historical examples, if you have a war, then there is a silent agreement that in the war we are not attacking the hospitals. It have been this way hundreds of years, or at least last 100 years. I have lots of examples that we are not attacking hospitals. We are attacking. We are having this war against each other, but not attacking the hospitals. So I saw many news when those hackers or organized cybercrime units, they promised that we are not attacking the healthcare sector or medical sector. During the COVID-19 crisis or before that, basically I have saw those examples in many different periods, also before the COVID. So they try to be, like a respectful bad guys, that we are attacking everybody else, but we are not attacking hospitals. But actually, this is nice, PR trick. So we all know that this is not true. Even if there are a couple of cybercrime units who actually think the way and act the way that we are not attacking the hospitals, and also they promise that if we do some wide scanning and wide ransomware spreading, and some of the hospital gonna be hit, then we are sharing a key for free, encryption key for the hospital. But the actual situation is that different attacks against hospitals have increased all the time. So basically, bad guys are focusing only on illegal income. So they don't care who pays money, who pays ransom. Is it the rich company, poor company? Is it the government institution or hospital? So their only focus is on profit, and they know that if hospital gonna lose their data, their data of their patients, then it's so critical that most probably hospital gonna pay money. And once again, I wanted to say that this no more healthcare cyber attacks is nice PR campaign, because if you see those different cases, worldwide cases, when the hospitals have become the victims of the ransomware attack or any different kind of cyber attack, we have most probably have the most different examples from the sector, because once again, they know this data there is very important. They know that they pay, and we have those examples, lots of those examples when they're focusing on the medical sector. But again, so my simple point is that why hospitals or medical sector organizations are so vulnerable? A, they don't have backup. B, if they have backup, this backup is not working. So simple ABC, what have to be done. Doesn't matter which level you have to explain this to, the management level or to the IT level, you have to understand that. You have to have backup, and you have to have this knowledge that if I need restore from backup, it actually gonna work. So simple example is that if you have backup in place, then I know hospitals working 24/7. It's quite difficult to find this time when this need of service is low, when we can switch off some real life system and let's try to restore from the backups and see is it work or not. But you have to do it. If you will do this in real life, this is the only way you can have information that yes, if needed, it works. Because if you're talking about ransomware attacks, then there was 10 years different ransomware attacks when the only focus was to encrypt your data and ask ransom. Last year and a half, they changed their way to attack. They're encrypting your data, and if you say that I don't pay because I have a backup and my restoring mechanism works just fine, they will tell you that we will publish your data. So all couple of years ago, encrypted the data. If you had a backup, everything was good. But right now, they are not just encrypting your data; they are also copying your data before they're encrypting it. So even if you have a backup, they are able to, you know, go and publish your information. But if you're talking about the medical sector, then in the end of the day, to lose data versus to publish data, then which one is more serious? So I don't care if my data is going to be published somewhere. So if someone is going to steal my medical data from a hospital, but I need that this data is in place in this hospital. So this is important, because if something going to happen with me and I will go to the hospital, they have to know how to treat me. They have to know what is my I don't know, blood type, if I need a blood transfer or something. But there is lots of different things we have to focus. So even if you don't have resources to focus all the problems, once again, focus those ABC that you're going to be over the average. I will skip those medical examples. I have lots of medical ransomware and malware attack examples here. And I will go forward with the next topic. By the way, this is one of the best defacement what I saw. And why this is the best defacement? All those examples what I just showed you about weak systems, and not the weak systems, but basically unprotected systems. It's not so difficult to be, you know, house robber when all the doors of the houses are open. So you don't have to go and, you know, brute force to open different locks because all the doors are open. And also, I like the second sentence of this defacement what I saw. Maybe our skill is zero, but your security is minus one. And this is presenting the best way, the situation, worldwide cyber situation. Nowadays, it's quite easy to be a bad guy, because it's easy to attack. Because, again, it's there is so many weak systems, so many vulnerabilities everywhere. And people are focusing in the wrong place. So, once again, try to have your security a little bit over the minus one, a little bit over the zero. And then those zero skills bad guys are not able to attack you, because otherwise we are facing the same problems everywhere in the same way. So once again, this backup, and restoring. So this ransomware case is the most serious case right now, and there is only simple couple of rules. What else I wanted to say to explain you? We have to not educate only our management and not only our end users, but we have to also explain to the IT guys what is the responsibility they are carrying on every day. Because IT guys usually they know very well how to build up different systems. They know very well how to maintain those systems. But I don't want to say always, but quite often they don't understand the full picture. They don't understand the full responsibility of those systems they are actually maintaining daily basis. Maybe they know that this is an important box and they know how to configure this box, but sometimes they are you know, missing this knowledge that maybe our emergency or rescue service dependent on this box. So if this box is going to be down, broken, attacked, or encrypted, or whatever, then not only this box is down, or device is down, or information system is down, the whole national service is going to be down. So that's why we have to somehow, yes, from one side, we have to say thank you to the IT guys, but from other side, we have to also explain that the responsibility of their work is increasing every day, and they have to understand the responsibility of this work. This is not just, you know, building the blocks. That one block is you know, the email server, and this is the web server, and this is the storage, and this is the domain controller. But all this wall have to be, you know, stand still, even with the winds and storms. So you have to have your architects in place who are able to see the whole picture. Because someone has to see it a little bit wider. And the big problem quite often is the language between different levels, in the management level, between the IT level and so on. But I will bring you this example of languages a little bit later. So if you, even if you have in place the overview of your assets, so those nice and shiny pictures are not good enough. This is my message. That kind of picture doesn't give you everything. Yes, of course, it's nice to have those pictures that we have, those different registers and information systems and databases and so on and so on. This is, by the way, one of the most popular picture of Estonian information systems, so different systems, our popular X-Road and ID card and so on, so on, so on. But at the end of the day, important is to have this picture. This is the result of different scanning from different scanning tools, and then you have to know what are those small purple or green dots here, and who's responsible for this dot, and where is this dot is standing for, and for the bad guys it's enough when this one dot is just, you know, not secured enough, or one port is open for this dot, and basically game is over again. And another thing is different cross dependencies, so you have to know what this green dot here does. So if this dot going to be down for some reason, cyber attack or whatever other reason, then what is the different cross dependencies? So again, if you're going to the management and explaining that we have a problem with domain controller, and the management going to say, you, I don't know what the domain controller is, and don't bother me with that kind of questions, and if domain controller going to be down, then what happened? Everything going to be down. So you are able, you have to able to explain those important things with the simple language to the management. And then if you're talking about the different cross dependencies, then for example, this domain controller is sometimes maybe more important than your website or any other services. So this is simple example of the complex language. So from my point of view, there is a IT guys, legal people, and medical people using the most complex language. But my message always is that there is possibility to explain even complex things, even complicated things with a simple language. And this is one good example what I saw once in the internet. So example how vice versa, basically. So how the simple things could be explained very complicated way. So do you know what is this formula in the screen? Most probably it's quite difficult to understand, and nobody says, I don't have no clue what the formula is. But just, you know, example for you. This is 3.5 part of gin, half part of vermouth, 4 ice cubes shaken equals martini, the James Bond favorite drink. So this is simple example how you can explain simple things very complicated way. And also vice versa. Actually, there is a way to explain very complicated things simple way. And my message to you is that if you have to explain to the management some complicated IT topics, don't use IT language. Choose your language based on your audience. And for the management level, you have to, you know, translate those IT issues to the strategic issues. You have to know that if you have a problems with the domain controller, it actually means that none of our employees are able to work if this system is down. So this is important system, and so on, so on. So this choose your language is important to choose correct way. I will skip couple of things, but again, some of the most important things. Know your assets, know your infrastructure. This is one joke from the Twitter when chief information security officer is going to ask how much of Windows hosts do we have in our organization, and all the different departments or people from different responsibilities will give you different answers. So antivirus guy will say that we have 7,000, desktop management guys will say that we have 6,000 Windows computers, security incident event management team going to say that we will collect logs from 9,000 computers. So this is the regular picture from every company. But the main point is that all those numbers have to be one and same. So if you have Windows hosts, then someone have to know all those Windows hosts. Another important thing, if you're talking about our resilience than order penetration tests from somewhere or do it by yourself if you have knowledge and tools. So only then you can have this knowledge that we are over the average and the bad guys with most simple scans and then the injects cannot our systems. So there's lots of different simple automated pen testing tools to do this basic average pen tests. Of course, you have if you order those white hats from some companies, they are able to provide much deeper penetration tests to your systems. But you can do lots of things by yourself. So again, if you're talking about the compare of the physical world and then the cyber world, then you can go outside of your private house. You can take the teaspoon and you can try to open your door lock with the teaspoon. So if your door lock opens with a teaspoon, so it basically means that every child can come inside of your property. So small important aspects. So couple of last thing what I wanted to explain to you is once again. Compliance is not the most important thing, and someone has to explain this to the management. So even if we do things by the book, it doesn't mean that we are actually able to stand against different cyber attacks. So this is the good joke of it. So everything is getting hit by phishings, there's no budget, and so on, so on, but we passed the security audit. So please try to avoid to have such situation, but it all becomes from the knowledge and mindset of the management, and someone have to explain the situation to the management. Also, there is a golden rule that you cannot waste the good crisis. And every time if something gonna happen, you have some breach or you are a victim of cyber attacks, you have to go management and explain our situation is bad, we are the victim because of, and usually again this good funny picture explain the situation. If you don't have had different cyber attacks in a while, most probably you don't have a good cyber budget. If something gonna happen, then management gonna start to pay your money. I remember also from Estonian Tax and Custom Board once when I explained the different risks and asked money for mitigation measures, and management didn't approve my application for this extra budget, and then something happened, and what happened exactly from my risk assessment, what I just explained, what may happen. And then there was very simple question, how much do you need? So once again, if something gonna happen, you have to use this as a good example. So all the bad things can be also the good things. Think about airplane industries. So why the planes are so secure? Because every time something happened with planes, they change their security measures and things. So if we don't face so much of different plane crashes or incidents previously, most probably our planes would be much less secure today. But all those incidents, all those crises made planes much more secure. This is the normal way. So if many people felt good during this lockdown because of this COVID crisis and had some rest, then cybersecurity people most probably got extra load of work because the increase of different kind of cyber attacks raised quite heavily. If people started to work from home, there was appears different kind of risks from their home. So again, if you are taking care of the risk assessment in the company, if you are the chief information security officer or dealing in cybersecurity, you have to have this overview of the situation. The situation changes, so people are not working anymore in the office, working at home. It means there is extra work for you. There's extra measures, security measures you have to implement, and so on. So for the last thing, what I wanted to explain to you is those exercises to basically your preparedness for different kind of situations. I just a couple of weeks ago I gave one presentation for one Estonian hospital, and this Estonian hospital explained to me that they did 1 year ago huge pandemic exercise between two biggest hospital in Tallinn, capital of Estonia. Basically, they played through this COVID scenario before we had information about the COVID. It was interesting. So they were preparing some pandemic situation, that if you have some huge virus situation, how big hospitals gonna be ready on the situation they never saw before, because obviously this COVID-19 situation nobody saw before. And they gave me a couple of excellent examples. What is the difference between the real life exercises and tabletop exercises? So basically, just one example I give you. They did tabletop exercise and they were prepared for everything. So we have to have masks and those rubber gloves, and the frontline, those emergency services doing this and doing that. And they played through all the different scenarios, how those hospitals and frontline emergency service gonna work during this virus pandemic. And then when COVID actually hit, there was a funny and a sad thing. So if those medical doctors were wearing the masks and wearing the rubber gloves, and they're using tablets for information, getting the patient information and putting to the hospital information system, the tablets is not working with the rubber gloves. So in the paper, tabletop exercise, everything was excellent. Everything worked, we are prepared. And then you have actual situation, you have a doctor with all those protective measures, the mask and then the rubber gloves, and actually he or she cannot work because there's a small technical issue. Tablets or smartphones or this touchscreen and the rubber gloves just not working. So for work, they have to remove the glove. If you're removing those rubber gloves, they can affect with the virus. So once again, if you're doing those exercises, please to think through different situations. The backup versus restoring from the backup is best example. Compliance, check. We have backup, reality, minus the restoring mechanism is not working. Again, compliance, medical doctors have all the security measures. Reality, they cannot work because rubber gloves and the touchscreen is not working. So play through different scenarios and be a little bit over the average. And most probably you can escape from the lion in the desert. So simple things, but I don't know, 80 or 90% of the companies are not even doing those simple things, and that's why the situation is as bad as it is. One important message to you, this is my last slide. One important message to you is, don't have this illusion that we are able to configure or set up our systems the way that we're never gonna get hit. You will get hit. The only question is how fast and how simple way you are able to fix this situation. You will get hit by ransomware. Okay, fine. Let's throw away this computer or information system. Let's restore. I don't know, there's gonna be a 6-hour break and the business go on. So you will see different incidents. It's okay. It's absolutely okay. The question is, what is the damage of those incidents? And it's not so difficult to create different measures and decrease the maximum damage. And first of all, your company, your agency, your organizational IT security employees have to be your biggest friend nowadays. They need to have resources. They need to have a skill set. So train them, give them resources, and most probably you will be over the average. Another biggest friend, what you have, is National Cert. Sri Lanka Cert is very good. So if you have problems, if you need help, advice, most probably they will help. I have worked with them last 1.5 year, and I know their capability, and they're getting better and better every day. And of course, cybercrime units from police, or if this is cybercrime, it is cybercrime, so do your application for police. They need this information. They need someone have to deal with actually the bad guys as well. So three important contacts if something gonna happen. So it's already over the 60 minutes from my side. So thank you very much. And Dean, you're muted.
Yes, Clyde. Thank you so much. That was an amazing talk. What more we can ask for? You spoke about incident response in terms of physical world and cyber world. You spoke quite a lot of things, and I would like to reflect on them. It's important to be proactive and reactive, but how important do you think reactive needs to be equal as proactive?
Usually it depends how good you are in proactive measures, because I know that those proactive activities sometimes may be a little bit boring, because you are preparing for something, and those reactive activities are more interesting, because then the house is already burning, and to be the firefighter, then it's interesting to do this work. But in the end of the day, of course, my strong recommendation is that proactive measures and activities have to be a little bit more important. Then you can avoid, and you can save your time to fight the fires when actually the situation is bad. And no one from our side like to, you know, fight with fire. So own this fire extinguisher and own this smoke detector is much more nice, and to play with them, not to play with actual fire. So this is simple answer from my side. We lost you, team. Okay, then I can, as long as they're fixing, there are probably some technical issues there. I try to answer a couple of questions what I see here in the chat. So do you have any other cybersecurity workshop or certification courses? Actually, we have, as I'm representing Cyber for Dev program, this is European Union funded program, then Google Cyber for Dev, I will put this link to the chat. We have training prospectus there, and through the Sri Lanka CERT, who is our main point of contact in Sri Lanka, we are able to arrange different kinds of cybersecurity workshops and trainings. There is lots of, how to say, non-technical trainings where there is no limitations of participants, so we can arrange some huge cybersecurity trainings, and it's pleasure to do this. We have also many technical trainings. Of course, if you're talking about technical hands-on trainings, then we have some limitations of participants. So it's again, we are keen to provide those trainings, and Sri Lanka CERT is our point of contact. So through them, we are able to provide those for the critical information infrastructure providers or vital service providers. So this is one thing. Next question. What are the suitable frameworks for cybersecurity management? So so once again, I wanted to say that there is no one single silver bullet what could I suggest, because depends on the area you are working, depends on the size of your organization, depends on the many different aspects. There are different kind of frameworks, because even if, for example, if I can say that ISO 27000 is very good cybersecurity standard, but your company size is 50 to 100 employees, then obviously the ISO 27000 is like a tank, but you need a bullet. So it's too complicated, it's too expensive, and so on, so on. So it all depends on the cybersecurity. If you're choosing cybersecurity measures and frameworks, you have to do some internal like assessment. What do we need? For example, by the way, we have one security standards training. So it's basically not the training about one security standard, but this is the training where we are explaining what is the difference between the different standards. So it's a cool training to get this overview and to understand if you need to choose one of the standards, then which one it is. Okay, Dean, you are back now.
Thank you. Yeah, that's been a bit of an issue, but thank you, Clyde, for answering those questions. I liked a few things that you said, especially about mindset. I mean, I think that plays an important role in today's world. Changing people's mindset is so difficult at times. I think the comparison between a computer and a phone. We always treat a computer as a more precious device than a phone. We say phone is just a phone, but we literally do everything, more things than what we do on a computer. And also you said about awareness raising in terms of attitude and discipline. I think that is also another important role. I mean, attitudes and discipline, the examples that you took from the physical world to the cyber world, for example, fire extinguisher versus backups. Now, we do comply with things. Now we know, right? Okay, fire extinguisher is there, the contract gets renewed. Yes, but we test them, right? And same thing when it comes to the backup, right? Procedures are in place, policies in place to make sure that the backup is done, yes. But how often, I mean, do we test it? And when there's a disaster and when we want to restore it, that's when we feel that, right, we fail to do something. So that testing also plays an important role. Clyde, I'm not sure, but what is that secret formula that you showed us? I'm still trying to figure out the answer for the formula that you showed.
Hello. James Bond, the movie star James Bond, favorite drink, martini. You know this cocktail?
Yes.
There is a vermouth, gin, and ice cubes. It's a martini formula. So again, very simple thing. So it's you know, just example how it's possible to explain simple things very difficult. So
very, very, very nicely told, Clyde. Clyde, I have one thing for you. What is the worst cyber attack that you've experienced? It could be as a nation or personally as a CEO, you've been head of different organization. And how did you respond to those? And how did you come out of that incident? I mean, just one small incident that you can share with us.
In our case, from Estonia, it's I don't, most probably you have heard that 2007 obviously was one of the most biggest attack what we have saw here, and the question wasn't about one attack. The question is what is the consequences of this attack? How much of different services are down? So nowadays, if you are looking different Estonian government regulations and laws, how to implement or how different vital service providers have to implement security measures and how they have to do the risk assessment, then Estonian government focusing mostly and very strongly of the continuity, so basically of the availability. So if the service is down, nothing to do, we cannot use the service. If the 911 emergency service is down, people cannot get help. If the hospital is down, by the way, there was a couple of weeks ago, there was in Germany, one hospital was out of service because of the ransomware. They have to start to move patients from one hospital to another, and at least one patient died because of that. So if someone is going to say that in cyber war there is no dead people, then I could say we have so many deaths already because of the cyber attacks, but not, you know, directly, but kinetically. So we have to focus mostly on the situation where this availability is very important. For example, by the way, before 2016, most of the cybersecurity experts and cybersecurity companies were talking about most possible biggest consequences cyber attack against energy sector, against power plant. And then December 2016, there was first cyber attack against Ukraine energy plant. In the middle of the winter, there was minus degrees outside. There was something like a couple hundred thousand people without electricity. It means without heating system in the winter with the minus degrees. So till the December of 2016, it was theoretically the most, you know, the worst cyber attack possible. But from the December 2016, it's not theoretical anymore. It actually happened. So I could say different kind of availability attacks against the national critical infrastructure.
Thank you, Clyde. Thank you so much. And I don't think there's any other questions from our audience. So let me thank you. Thank you for your time. It's been OD for giving us this opportunity and giving an excellent speaker. So thank you, Clyde. Thank you so much. I do want to remind our audience for tomorrow. We have two sessions coming up tomorrow, one at 10 to 11, and then from 2 to 3. So the first session is about done by CERT staff, again, about ATM fraud and on the rise. So it's about the issues that we've come across, the things that have been reported to us by the police and the investigations that we've done. We would like to share a few things about that. Expert Adli Bahid from APNET. Again, a well-known speaker. It's going to speak to us about malicious activities and honeypots. So that's again in an afternoon session. So that's all from us for today. And I hope to see you guys connected tomorrow. So please, those who still are interested in joining us, please do register. Our information is available on cert.gov.lk/CSW2020. And also all information, flyers, if you are looking for information, it's on our CERT Facebook page. All the sessions have been recorded and will be available on YouTube. It's live on Facebook. It's on POTV and so on. Let me finally thank our sponsors, Cisco for giving us a platform, Soteria for it'll be 28th. And if you're still not registered, and if you're interested, please do register for the event. It's completely free. And then SLT, Mobitel, Dialogue, the participants watch all these sessions for free. Thank you so much. So hope to see you guys again tomorrow. Thank you. Bye.